So before we start with the actual discussions for today, any questions from anyone, please? Any questions? Okay, no questions. Fine. So in today's session, we'll talk about the process called as purchasing and making the payment, and another process called as performing the sales and receiving money, nothing but receipt. Okay, so purchasing and payment, right from purchasing to till payment, what are the steps are involved, and from the sales activity to till we receive the payment from customer, what process typically or any questions? Okay, fine. So we'll talk about these two processes. The first one is purchasing and making the payment. The second process is selling something to customer and collecting the payment from the customer. Okay, first we'll talk about the purchasing process, purchasing and making the payment to suppliers. So when I talk about purchasing and making the payment to suppliers, the first there should be some need of purchasing. So who manage the stock in the organization, inventory, right? So inventory department is responsible to maintain the stock. They'll maintain the stock, say, or items. Okay, it can be anything. So it could be raw material or finished good, whatever inventory department will maintain. Okay. So say for example, there is some requirement from the customer. Customer contacted sales department saying the customer required 100 laptops. So we are into laptop sales. The customer contacted. So there is one customer. The customer contacted sales department saying they need 100 laptops. Contacted. Now what sales department do? The sales department will verify the stock availability with inventory department. Now the sales department will contact inventory department to check the stock availability. Say within the inventory, here the item is nothing but we are talking about laptops, so we'll take the same. So within the inventory, we have 1000 laptops. So there is some order from the customer. The order is received by sales department. So now sales department is contacting the inventory department to check the stock availability within the inventory. Customer order for laptops, how many? 100. So within the inventory warehouse, we have 1000 laptops. Now what normally we do? If laptops are available, what sales department will do? Anyone please?
It will take it from inventory and send to customer.
Yes, exactly. So before that, once they identify the stock availability, they'll just give the confirmation to the customer as they are going to deliver the laptops. By following the respective organization process, they'll be just delivering the material to customer. Fine. So in this scenario, we don't need to purchase anything, right? Now we'll take the example as same case, just customer is placing the order, okay, and sales department is receiving order from the customer for 100 laptops. When they check the stock availability within the inventory we have only 10 laptops. Now, what inventory department has to do? When stock is not available, as per the demand, they have to raise the requisition. Okay, they have to identify how much stock is required. Okay, customer order is for 100 laptops, only 10 laptops are available. At least to fulfill this customer requirement, we have to get 90 laptops. For that reason, inventory department has to raise the requisition. Okay, what does it mean, the requisition? Requisition means addressing. They'll specify which item we have shortage, how much item we required within the inventory, and those details they'll be documenting as a requisition. Okay, they have to raise the requisition. Whenever they identify the requirement need within the inventory based on the customer order, they'll create the requisition and they have to get the approvals for that. So within the inventory department, who has authority to approve the requirements which rises in the inventory based on the customer orders, or else there could be some need within the organization itself. Say within our organization, we need 10 laptops. So if you are dealing with the laptops in your business, definitely will check in the inventory. So stock is not available to sell to the customer or to use internally. Definitely we have to raise the requisition. We raise the requisition for 90 laptops, or you may plan to get more also depending on how you are planning, but as per this example, so we need 90 laptops. We'll raise the requisition for 90 laptops, and for 90 laptops, okay, we have to get the approvals from inventory manager or supervisor. Once the requisition is approved by inventory department, this information will pass to purchasing department. Okay, purchasing department. So inventory department will communicate the information to purchasing department, saying that we need 90 laptops and we raise the requisition that got approved. So that means this approved requisition information, inventory department will be sharing with purchasing department. So the approved requisition information they'll be sharing with the purchasing department. What purchasing department will do, based on that purchase requisition, okay, they will create the RFQ. RFQ stands for request for quotation. So we require 90 laptops. So the purchasing department will take initiative of getting the quotations from the supplier for that. They'll be requesting for quotations. They'll create the RFQ and they'll be sending to the suppliers saying that we need so and so brand laptops with the so and so configuration. So this is this much quantity we required. With all these specifications, the purchasing department will send the quotations to suppliers. So in return, we'll get the quotations from the suppliers. So we are sending the quotation, we are asking for quotation, request for quotation. We are requesting for quotation from the supplier. So suppliers will be sending that, quotations will be received by purchasing department. Purchasing department will receive quotations from suppliers, are called as vendors. Okay. So suppliers will be providing the quotation. Once purchase department receive the quotation from the suppliers, the purchasing department has to analyze those quotations. Which supplier is just giving the best price and which supplier is giving the best terms. We know the price, right? When I talk about terms, it's generally payment terms. Say one supplier may give the quotation, each laptop is 20,000 and we have to pay immediately. The other supplier can give the quotation, the same laptop, 22,000, we can pay after two months. So organization will choose, okay, based on the margin, what they'll be getting and the financial position of the organization. They'll just look into many other aspects and they'll take the decision whether they want to go with a 22,000 or 20,000 price of laptop based on the terms. That we call as quotation analysis. will receive the multiple quotations from the different suppliers, and purchasing department will perform quotation analysis. Simply you can call as quote analysis also. Okay, quotation analysis is nothing but analyzing all the quotations and understanding who is giving the best price and who is accepting best terms. Okay, fine. After quotation analysis, we can identify who is offering the best price and who are just offering the best terms, who are okay with the terms, who are giving the payment terms as a 2 months or 3 months, however we are expecting. So after that analysis, we'll pick the best quotation. Okay, we have to select the best quotation. If say pick or select best quotation. After selecting the best quotation, what purchasing department will do? They'll place the order. They'll create the order. Create order. What purpose we are creating order? To purchase. Okay. Purchase order. Simply we call as PO. So before we send this order to the supplier, internally, normal organization will have a process called as approvals. They'll get the approvals for the order and they'll be sending the order. However, we are just getting the approvals for requisition also. We create the requisition which talks about the requirement in the organization that has to be approved, then only that can be moved to the next step, which can be initiated by purchasing department. Once approved requisition information is received by purchasing department is going to raise the, they are going to create the RFQs, request for quotations, and they'll receive the quotation from the suppliers. And after receiving the quotations, they have to look after all the quotations, which you call as a quotation analysis. Out of that, they'll be selecting the best one based on which elements, which criteria, which conditions, which points they'll take into consideration, price, and many, many just points they'll take into consideration. That completely depends on which product they are purchasing and how that organization is expecting to have a terms with the supplier. All they take into consideration, they'll be selecting the best quotation from one or multiple vendors, and they will, purchasing department will raise the purchase order. They'll create the purchase order. They'll take the approvals. The same purchase order they'll be passing to supplier. Once supplier receives the order from the purchasing department, they'll respond to that. What they'll do, they'll supply the material. Then organization will receive the material. Okay, receive item, say here laptops. The reality, these laptops will be received by inventory department. Okay, when you are placing the order, within the purchase order, we can specify to which location supplier has to send the laptops. Based on that, they'll be sending. Okay, generally, normally this would be inventory location. Okay, as a part of process, just I'm writing it. So you can just receive the laptops. And after receiving the laptops, so next step is we have to make the payment. To make the payment, the inventory purchasing department will contact payables department. Payables department saying we purchased this much quantity of laptops with this price, and just by following this information, please process the payment. That means the purchasing department is going to pass this received laptops information. What are the laptops they received? They'll be passing to payables department based on that information. Okay, from which supplier they purchased, what they purchased, how much quantity, price, all the details they'll be sharing with the payables department based on the information which payables is receiving from purchasing. They'll create the purchase invoice. We'll create the purchase invoice. So within the purchase invoice, we'll have all the information, who is the supplier, okay, how much amount we have to pay, when we have to pay, how we have to pay, okay, where we have to send the payment, all the details we'll be having. So whenever we arrive at the due date, the payables department will be responsible to make the payment. The payables department will make the payment. And this payables department will be sending this payment information to cash department. cash department, okay, the payables department will be sharing this information to cash department, because the cash department require this payment information to perform the bank statement reconciliations payments. And the payables department is creating purchase invoice based on the purchases are done by purchasing department. Sometimes we may purchase assets also. Sometimes we may purchase assets also. If that purchase invoice is related to asset, that information the payables department will be sharing with asset department. Okay. What payables department do? The purchase invoice. If the purchase invoice related to some expense or some services or inventory related items, the payables department won't share that purchase invoice information with asset department. If the purchase invoice is related to some asset, we purchase one building or some plant or vehicle, so against that we got invoice from the supplier or else we received information from purchasing department, then only the purchase invoice information will be shared with asset department. So what asset department will do? Based on that information, they'll maintain the assets. Okay, what are the purchase invoice information they're receiving? The purchase invoice says what we purchased. So that they have to maintain as asset in the organization. So within the asset department, they'll maintain all the details. And based on usage, the asset department will calculate the depreciation. So that's what asset department do. Finally, all these departments will be sharing the data with common department. What all these departments will do? So this asset department will be sharing all the data with the common department, and the payables department will be sharing purchase invoices and payment information with the common department. And this cash department also will be sharing the cash related information which is maintained through bank accounts. And purchasing department also will be sharing all the receipt related information. And from inventory side also, whatever the stock we have, okay, the stock related information within the inventory, whatever the transactions takes place as a part of business, all the information will be shared with common department. Here the common department, based on all these activities, they'll prepare the financial reports. Okay, so these are the points we have to understand when you talk about purchasing and making the payment. See, the process is initiated by inventory department. The reason could be customer placed order to sales department and sales department is contacting the inventory department, and since stock is not available, inventory may take the responsibility of raising the requisition, or else there may not be customer and their sales department may not contact the inventory department. If there is any need, internal need also, yes, inventory will come into the picture. So they'll raise the requisition and it goes to purchasing department by following the different steps which we followed, which we discussed. So purchasing takes place and finally that information will be passed to payables department. Within the payables will create purchase invoice against the purchase and payment against the purchase invoice. The purchase invoice information will be shared with the asset department if the purchase invoice is related to asset related purchase, otherwise no. Okay, if it is expense related or inventory item related purchase invoice, we don't share with the asset department. And what are the payments we processed as a part of payables department? All the payment information payables department will be sharing with cash department. The cash department will get that information for bank statement reconciliation purpose. Okay, the cash department, what they do is other side they'll get the bank statement. Okay, so between their payables payments data and bank statement, they'll be verifying the record which you call as BRS, bank statement reconciliation. Finally, all these departments will be sending the data to common department. This is how the purchasing and payment process works. Okay, the process is starting with the requisition, ending with the payment. Even the process ending with the payment, how the data flows, how the communication happens, that we are trying to understand. So purchasing and payment means the process is getting initiated with the requisition and ends with the payment. But further, how that information or communication happens, that we are trying to understand. That's all. So this is all about purchasing and payment process. Okay, so we'll see here. I just prepared one simple flow diagram. We'll understand based on that. Okay, what inventory department do? If there is any requirement, if there is any shortage in the inventory, inventory department will raise the requisition, right? Requisition, and they have to get the approvals. Okay, they have to get the approvals. Before that, what is the responsibility? What is the purpose of inventory? They'll maintain the stock. Okay. Stock. So inventory is responsible to maintain the stock, and if any shortage within the inventory, they'll raise the requisition, they'll get the approvals. Then inventory department will be passing this approved requisition information to purchasing department, saying that we have so and so requirement, so we got approval for that. Based on that communication, the purchasing department will take initiative of raising RFQ, request for quotation. Just now we discussed, right? Request for quotation. They'll raise the RFQ and they'll receive the quotations from vendor. After receiving the quotations from vendors, they do the analysis, which we call as quote analysis or quotation analysis. After doing the quotation analysis, they choose the best quotation out of that. After choosing the best quotation, the purchasing department will place purchase order. They'll place the purchase order, PO. After placing the order to the suppliers, what supplier will do? Supplier will supply the material. So the organization will receive that material. So in the purchase order itself, will be mentioning to which location supplier has to supply the material. So based on that, we'll receive. So that we call as we'll receive. Okay. For that, we'll create the receipt. Okay, we'll create the receipt. That simply you can call as whenever we'll receive the material. Let me write it. We'll receive the material. Whenever we receive the material, for that we'll create the receipt. What receipt? It's related to goods. Instead of simply calling it as receipt, you can call as GRN. Stands for goods receipt note. Could you please keep on mute, please? So if you have any question, you can unmute and you can talk, Srinu.
Okay.
Please. Okay. So organization will receive the material. For that, the purchasing department or inventory department will prepare the GRN. GRN stands for goods receipt note. Then this purchasing department will pass this receipt or GRN information with payables department. Whenever payables department receive that receipt information from purchasing department, the payables department will prepare the purchase invoice. And whenever they process the payment, they'll create the payment record. Okay. Or else let me write in this way. Process wise, we can understand. So the payables department will create purchase invoice, and whenever they process the payment, they'll record, create the, whenever they arrive at the due date, they'll make the payment. So this purchase invoice is related to asset purchase. The payables department will be sharing this purchase invoice information with asset department. If this purchase invoice related to some expense or inventory item, payables department won't share that information with asset department. If it is purchase invoice, if it is asset invoice, the payables department will share that information with the asset department. Asset department, based on that purchase asset purchase invoice, asset department will prepare asset. They'll create the asset in their department, and they'll, based on usage, they'll calculate the depreciation. Okay, they'll create the calculate the depreciation. Now what payables department is doing, the payment information they are sharing with the cash department. They'll be sharing the payment information with the cash department. What cash department typically do, primarily they maintain the bank accounts and they'll perform the bank statement reconciliations. Okay, bank statement reconciliation. So already we discussed what is the meaning of bank statement reconciliation. So it's all about verifying our system data with a bank statement. As per our accounts payables, how many payments we issued, how many payments are reflecting in the bank statement. That cross-checking process only we call as bank statement reconciliation. Finally, all these applications will be sharing the data with general or common department. Okay, from inventory, this transaction data goes to common department. From purchasing, payables, cash management and assets, from all the places data goes here. I just given the this arrow representation two sides. That means there will be two-way communication. When you are working on the application, you can understand, but as of now, the simple point you can take, these departments will be sharing the data with this common department. So what this common department do, the data which is received by this common department or general department, the all data is related to financial data. Okay, here primarily here cash payables and all. Okay, and here inventory and purchasing, this is not financial related data. Here no financial transaction. So to generate the financial transaction, the other transaction which are initiative based transactions only we can see. Once data is received by this common department, the common department can prepare the financial reports. Okay, financial reports can be prepared by this department. Now what inventory department is doing, they are maintaining the stock. If there is any shortage, they have to raise the requisition and they have to go with the approval process. To maintain the stock, to raise the requisition, to perform the approvals, from Oracle side we have an application called as Oracle Inventory. We have application called as Oracle Inventory, in short we call as INV. That means by using the Oracle Inventory INV application, we can maintain the stock and we can create the requisitions and we can get the approvals within the system process. Fine. So the inventory department, from inventory department will pass this information to purchasing department. What purchasing department is doing? The purchasing department is raising the RFQs. That means they are requesting for quotations. They are receiving the quotation. They are doing the quotation analysis. They are choosing the best. Out of that, they are placing the purchase orders. Again, for purchase orders also, they will have approvals. They will have approvals and they will receive the material from the supplier. And if required, they will do the returns also, right? Purchase returns. Okay, purchase returns. So we received material from the supplier, but some quantity of material got damaged. In that case, we'll perform the purchase returns. So these all activities can be handled by purchasing department, or else this receiving and purchase returns can be performed from inventory side. Okay, it's all about how they just manage within their organization process. But application point of view, in these two applications, Oracle given the flexibility of performing this. Okay, so this is how, these are the activities basically done by purchasing department. To perform all these activities, we have application from Oracle called as Oracle Purchasing. Okay, we have application called as Oracle Purchasing. Within the purchasing, very primary activity is placing the order to supplier. Whenever you place the order, then only you can get the response from the supplier with the stock, whatever you requested. So that is the reason short name is PO. So in terms of purchase order, short name is purchase order. PO means, in terms of transactions, PO means purchase order. in terms of applications, PO means purchasing. You have to understand here, PO we have here and here. So in terms of process, PO means purchase order. In terms of applications, PO means purchasing application. Fine. So now what purchasing department do, or purchasing department, they will be passing this receipt information to payables department. So payables department will create the purchase invoice based on the receipt information which they are receiving from purchasing. And whenever they make the payment, they'll record the payment. That means payables department is responsible to create and maintain the purchase invoices and to process the payment. To create the purchase invoices and to process the payments from Oracle, we have an application called as Oracle Accounts Payable. Oracle Accounts Payable. AP. Fine. Now what accounts payables department is doing, AP is doing, or simply you can call as payables. What payables department will do, if the invoice which is recorded by payables department, if that is related to asset, the payables department will pass that information to asset department. What asset department will do, based on that purchase, asset related purchase invoice information, okay, asset invoice, simply you can call it as asset invoice. If that invoice is related to asset, then only that information will be passed to asset department. Based on that asset invoice, asset department will create asset, and based on the usage, they do the depreciation calculation. And to maintain the assets and to calculate the depreciation, we have an application from Oracle as Oracle Fixed Assets. We call as FA, Fixed Assets. So what payables department is doing, the payables department will share the payment information to cash department. The cash department is responsible to maintain the bank accounts of the organization, and once they get the payments information from payables department to cash department, the cash department will use that payments data for bank statement reconciliation. That means the cash department primarily we use to maintain the bank accounts and to perform the bank statement reconciliations. To maintain the bank accounts and to perform the bank statement reconciliation, we have an application from Oracle called as Oracle Cash Management. Okay, we have an application called as Oracle Cash Management from Oracle. By using Oracle Cash Management, we can create and maintain the bank accounts and we can perform the bank statement reconciliations. This we call as CM, or we have other name also called as CE. The reason is normally we can use a CM. CM means cash management, but we have another application called as cost management also. Cost management, that is also CM. That is the reason normally you can refer cash management as a CE, cash entry. Okay, if you are going to use CM, nothing wrong. Okay, you can call it as CM or CE, but application table level, normally they are referred CE only. Okay, as of now, you can remember these two terms, you'll understand. So finally, all these, all the departments will share the data with a common department. Here now, for every department, we have a separate application. The system point of view, from all these applications, data will be received by this section. So this section, this area, for what purpose? Reports, financial report creation purpose. So this area of activities you can manage by using the application called as Oracle General Ledger. That means to prepare the financial reports, okay, for the data which is resulting from the financial applications and other applications, we have an application from Oracle called as Oracle General Ledger. GL. Okay, General Ledger. So this is how that communication takes place in the departments. In each and every department, there will be certain activities. Again, between the departments, there should be some sequential of communication should happen. Okay, so however the real-time communication happens in the business, the same you can establish within the system, the ERP. See, if you have any questions, Srinu, if you have any questions, you can just, you can unmute and you can ask. If you don't have any questions, please don't unmute. Okay.
Lakshman, this is Prashant here.
Yeah, Prashant, please.
Maybe my question is too early, but still I wanted to ask. That's why I'm asking. Yeah. See, between Oracle inventory to general ledger, as you said, all accounting entries will come into Oracle general ledger.
Correct.
So will we be seeing that accounting entries
yes.
in the application?
You can see that.
Okay. Yep. Okay. No. Are you going to explain to us?
Yeah, we'll do that. Just we'll create the transactions. If you want to see the accounting entries, yes, I'll show you that.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks. Fine. So this is all about the process which we call as purchasing and payment process. Okay, so typically the process name very generally or what Oracle given is P2P cycle. This process we call as P2P cycle. The P2P stands for, P stands for procure, okay, 2 means TO2, P stands for pay, procure to pay cycle, okay. P2P cycle. P2P stands for procure to pay. P stands for procure, 2 stands for this TO2 only represented as this numerical 2, and again P stands for pay, procure to pay. That means this process will support right from procurement to till we make the payment. So very primary. Hello? Fine. So primarily, these are the primary applications will be involved in the P2P cycle. So procure to pay, the procurement process will get initiated by inventory department by raising the requisition. If there is no requisition, the purchasing department may not purchase. So that is the reason the P2P cycle will get initiated by inventory department and it will end with a payment. That means payables. So in the P2P cycle, these are the three primary applications involved. The P2P cycle starts with the requisition and ends with the payment. Ends with the payment. So after payment also, how the data flows that we are discussing. If the data goes to cash management, finally all the data goes to general ledger. And if the asset invoice is related to asset, that goes to asset department. We are additional points also we are discussing. Tomorrow if somebody is going to ask you, explain P2P cycle, this is what we have to explain. Okay, when you talk about P2P cycle, you should be able to explain in this way. In a P2P cycle, if there is some demand in the organization, okay, the inventory will raise the requisition, they'll get the approvals, that information they'll pass to purchasing department. Based on the approved requisition, purchasing department will create the RFQs, they get the quotation from the vendors, they do quotation analysis and they'll choose the best quotation. And they'll place the order to purchase order to supplier with approvals. Whenever organization receive the material, they'll create the GRN or simply call as a receipt. If required, they do the returns also to suppliers. And based on the receiving, the purchasing department will share the receipt information with accounts payables department. Based on the receipt information, accounts payables department will create purchase invoice. So once the due date is arrived for the purchase invoice, they'll make the payment. The payment information, whatever payables is holding, the payables will be sharing the data with the cash management application for bank statement reconciliation. The whatever the purchase invoice information is available with accounts payables, if that purchase invoice is belongs to asset related purchase, the payables department will be sharing that information with asset department. Based on that, asset department will create assets and they'll calculate depreciation. Finally, from all the applications, or you can say from all the departments, data will be shared with the general ledger application to prepare the financial reports. This is how you should be able to explain if somebody is going to ask you the P2P as a question. Any questions here, please? Any question from anyone? Okay, just remember the short names. INV means inventory, Oracle inventory, PO means Oracle purchasing, AP stands for accounts payables, Oracle accounts payables, CMRC stands for Oracle cash management, GL, Oracle general ledger, FA, Oracle fixed assets. Done. Fine. So this is all about purchasing and making the payment. Now we'll look at sales process and recording the payment from the customer. So when I talk about this process, say we have a sales department. Okay, sales department. So sales, just sales department. What sales department do? Sales department will involve in the sales activities. So before they perform the sales, they have to receive the order from the customer. They'll receive orders from customers. Why they receive the orders from the customer? For the purpose of sale. They'll be selling, customer will place the order. Simply the order what they receive from the customer, for customer that is a purchase order, for organization point of view, for sales department that is a sales order. That means they receive the sales orders from customers. They'll receive the sales orders. SO means sales order. The sales department receives orders from customers, that we call as sales order. So once they receive the orders from the customer, what sales department do? The sales department should contact the inventory department. They have to contact the inventory department for stock availability. If stock is available, sales department should give the confirmation to the customer. That simply we call as book sales order. Okay, the first step is the sales department receives orders from the customers, which we call as sales orders. Sales department receives sales orders, and once they receive the order, within the order, what is the item customer is asking for and how much quantity required and all those information they'll verify, and they'll verify the stock availability within the inventory. That means sales department will have a communication with inventory department. So we have inventory department here, INV. Okay, sales department will check with the inventory for stock availability. They'll cross check with the inventory department. If inventory says stock is available, then they'll go with the next step. If inventory says stock is not available, then inventory will raise the requisition. They'll get the approvals, then purchasing process starts. But to understand the sales process, let's treat stock is available within the inventory. Now, what they have to do? They'll be giving the confirmation to the customer. As the sales department says, yes, we are going to supply the material as per your order. Okay, that we call as booking the sales order. Simply you can say book sales order. Book sales order is nothing but giving confirmation to the customer as we are going to supply the material. Done. Now when we talk about inventory, so stock would be in the within the inventory, right? So this is inventory. So within the inventory, you can have some segregations, which we call as sub-inventories. Okay, you can call as sub-inventories. Say, there are the two sub-inventories we have. So within the inventory, we have two sub-inventories. It's just segregation. The stock will segregate and will maintain. That is a sub-inventory. So now, the point here is, say here we have one sub-inventory, here we are maintaining the laptops. And here you are going to store desktops. Okay, fine. So the total area, okay, the total area we are treating as inventory organization. the total area we are calling as inventory, and within the inventory the segregation we are calling as sub inventory. Fine. Say for example you are purchasing the material. When you are purchasing the material from the supplier, you will receive the material and you may place that material in this location. Okay, in this location here. Okay, the space, buffer space what we have, you may place here. Then as a next step, you will be, if that stock is laptops, you will be moving into laptops sub inventory. If the stock whatever you received, that is the desktops, you will be placing in the desktop sub inventory. Okay, or else you are going to sell to the customer. If you are going to sell to the customer, what you will do is, first we will move this material from, okay, this sub inventory to this area. Or else let me address that. Okay. So this is a place. Whenever you are going to receive any, when you purchase directly, you may receive that material into this location first. From here, we'll be placing into respective sub inventories. If you are going to sell to the customers, in that process also, first what we'll do is, you may get this laptop from here to here, and in the same way desktops also from here to here. Here you may do some packing, or else truck may come into this location area and you can load into the truck and you can supply to your customer. So ultimately when we are going to get the stock into the right place, into this laptop sub inventory or desktop sub inventory, first you are taking into some place. Okay, first you are taking into this place, from here you are moving. When you are selling also, from here you will pick the laptops and you will place here. From here you will pick the desktops and you will be placing here. From here you will be shipping to the customer location. So this buffer area, whatever the area we are using for item inflows or outflows, when you purchase you will place here, temporary purpose will be moving into the right place. When you are going to sell, before we load into the truck, we will place the material here. There you may do some packing or other activities also, but this is a common place which we are using. This place you can call as staging area. The stock will keep their temporary purpose, that we call as staging area. Okay, when you talk about inventory, the total area we are calling as inventory. Within that segregations we are calling as sub inventories. And the additional buffer space what we have within the inventory, that we are calling a staging area. Through that area only the items flows into inventory or moves out from the inventory. So that is the reason that we are calling a staging area. Now fine, here we are discussing about, we received order from the customer and sales department will give the confirmation to the customer. The confirmation only they'll record as a booking sales order. After booking the sales order, we have to supply the material to customer. So where we have stock? Within the sub inventories. The first step is we have to move this stock from this sub inventories to staging. First step is we have to move. If you are going to sell laptops you have to move from sub inventory to staging area. This activity will be done by inventory department. So inventory department will involve the process of moving the material item from sub inventory to staging. Whenever this physical activity takes place within the inventory, the sales department will record in their books as the stock is moved from sub inventory to staging. How they will record? Inventory will inform, because sales department will ask inventory department saying that from so and so customer, we have so and so order, we have to supply 50 laptops. So that the sales department will inform to inventory department. In return, inventory department should pass that communication, what action they taken against that. So whenever inventory department move the material from a stock or say laptop or desktop from sub inventory to staging, inventory department will inform to sales department saying that yes, we moved laptops from the sub inventory to staging. Whenever the physical activity takes place within the inventory, sales department will record the same in their books as a quick release. they'll record as a quick release has happened. That means they released material from sub inventory to staging. Okay. The first step is moving the material from sub inventory to staging. What is the next step? We have to move the material from this staging to customer location. Who will do this activity? Inventory may involve, or else they have a separate department called as shipping department. That totally depends on organization size. Say inventory department or the shipping department move the material from the inventory, the staging to customer location. Who will come to know about it? The inventory department only will come to know with the communication, whatever they have with the shipping department. So whenever this physical activity takes place, inventory will pass that information to sales department saying that so and so item we ship to the customer. Whenever this sales department hear this information from inventory department, that activity they'll record in their books as a ship confirm. Ship confirm. That means inventory shipped material to customer, and the inventory will inform to sales department as we ship the material to customer. So sales department should maintain the proper records based on the movement of that order related activities. So tomorrow, customer will call to sales department, not to inventory department. So inventory is, sales department is receiving order and they are giving the confirmation. So if customer is going to call to sales department saying, what is the status of my order? If inventory is giving the proper update to sales department, they can communicate the same to customer. If inventory is going to inform to sales department saying that, yes, we picked the material and we placed in the staging and we did the packing. So sales department, if the inventory is going to inform to sales department, the same information they can pass to customer if they get call from the customer. And whenever sales department, this inventory department ship the material to customer, they have to communicate with the sales department. They'll maintain in their books. If customer is going to call to the sales department, they can respond by saying that, yes, shipping is done and you may receive today so-and-so time, the shipping is, we just initiated the shipping process, so you'll be receiving the material by today or tomorrow. That's how the proper communication they can have with the customer if inventory is going to have a communication with the sales department. So for that reason, against the sales order, whatever the activities will be performed by inventory department or shipping execution department, what are the departments they'll be deploying for that process. So those will keep giving the updates to sales department so that sales department can have a better communication, better information to the customer. Done. So shipment is done. We ship the material from our organization to our inventory, means our organization is a part of our organization, from our organization to customer location. Once customer receive that material, customer may identify some stock got damaged. So when we are purchasing, we may do the returns. In the same way, when you are supplying, our customer can return. Since you are selling, and if you are going to receive that back from the customer, that we call as sales returns. Sales returns is not a standard process, right? If there is such kind of scenario, the sales returns also will be managed by sales department only. If any returns from the customer, that also sales department will maintain the records. So what is the primarily, what is the responsibility of sales department? They'll receive the sales orders from the customers, and based on the stock availability, they'll book the sales order. Sometimes they may book the sales orders. Booking sales order is nothing but confirming the sales order. So even stock is not available in the inventory, they may confirm the sales order. They may book the sales order. How? So sales department can talk to the inventory, and inventory may say stock is not available, and inventory may talk to the sales department saying that you need stock in how many days. Say customer is asking within 10 days. So now sales department will inform to inventory department, we need so and so item within 10 days. Now inventory will talk to the purchasing department, so and so item we require within 10 days. Can you get into the inventory? If sales purchasing department says yes, we can purchase, then inventory will give the confirmation to sales department. You can go ahead and you can confirm to the customer We just spoke to purchasing department. They can get stock ready in the inventory less than 10 days time. So such kind of communication takes place. In that scenarios, even stock is not available within the inventory, the sales department will promise to the customer as they are going to supply. So if stock is available, they can give the confirmation to the customer. Even stock is not available, based on the possibilities of supply, they'll find the possibility, yes, we can supply. So by purchasing from the customer suppliers, in that scenarios also, they'll book the sales order. Once sales order booking is done, so once the stock is available within the inventory, so they'll move the material from sub-inventory to staging. Sub-inventory to staging, that process we call as pick release. Moving material from sub-inventory to staging, we call as pick release. The moving the material from staging to customer location, we call as ship confirmation. These two activities, the real pick release ship confirmations, will be done by inventory department directly, or inventory may take the help of shipping department if they have a department called shipping. Otherwise, inventory may handle all these activities. So when if customer is going to return the material what we sold, that we will be recording as a sales returns. This is the responsibility of sales department in any organization. So very basic activities what sales department do. So once this is done, the sales department will pass the information to receivables department. Okay, they'll pass the information to receivables department. What information they'll be passing? They'll be passing ship confirmation details. For which customer, how much quantity they ship, and in how many days customer is going to pay, how much customer is going to pay, all the information they'll be sharing in the form of ship confirmation. Simply you say, ship confirmation document they will share with the receivables department. Based on the ship confirmation information what receivables is receiving from the sales department, receivables department will create sales invoice. Okay, receivables department will create sales invoice based on ship confirmation details which they received from sales department. Okay, so within the sales invoice, which information we can have? Who's the customer? What we sold? How much customer has to pay? When customer is going to pay? All the details we can have within this. And whenever we receive the payment, who will receive the payment? Receivables department. Receivables department will follow up the customer, or else they can have a collection team also. So whatever the process they are following internally accordingly, they'll follow up the customer. Once they get the payment from the customer against the sales which they did, that means against the sales invoice, if they get the payment from customer, that they'll record as a cash receipt, or simply you can say customer receipt or just receipt. Okay, so the moment they receive the payment from the customer, receivables department will record it as a receipt. Now this receipt information they'll be sharing with the cash department. Okay, cash department. So they'll be sharing the receipt information. The payables department is sharing the payment information with the cash department. The same way, receivables department will share receipt information with cash department. So other side, they'll get the bank statement. So between the bank statement receipts and receivables receipts, they'll do the reconciliation, which we call as bank statement reconciliation. Okay, they'll perform the bank statement reconciliation. Finally, all this data will be sharing to common department. Okay, so all these departments will share the data with the common department. So this department will share, and receivables also will be sharing. From here also data comes, and based on these updates you can get the data from inventory also. From all the application you get the data into common department. Based on the data, common department can prepare the financial reports. So this is all about selling some item to the customer and finally receiving the payment. Okay, so the sales will be initiated by sales department. That starts with the sales order and it ends with the by receiving the payment from the customer. The process starts with the activity called as receiving the order from the customer, and it ends with after receiving the payment from the customer. So this is how the communication takes place. If there is any order from the customer, okay, that would be received by the sales department. So that simply we call as SO. Once they receive the sales order from the customer, they have to check with inventory for stock availability. If stock is available, they'll book the sales order. Even stock is not available, some scenarios they may book the sales order, okay, by planning to purchase and to purchasing and to sub to purchasing and to supplying to the customer. And whenever inventory move the material from sub inventory to staging, that activity, that movement, sales department will maintain in their books as a ship confirmation. Whenever we move the material from staging to customer location, okay, staging to customer location, okay, customer location or say customer organization, whatever you call that, we just sales department will record in their books as a ship confirmation. So once you ship the material to customer, sometimes customer may return the material back to our organization only because of some quality issues or damage. Okay, so in that case, the sales department will take the initiative of recording the same information in their books as a sales returns. So once this is done, the sales department will pass this ship confirmation details to receivables department. Based on this information, receivables department will prepare sales invoice. Whenever they get the payment from the customer against the sale, okay, they'll create the receipt. The receipt information they'll be sharing with the cash department, and that can be used by cash department for bank statement reconciliation purpose. Finally, from all the departments, data will be shared with the common department to prepare the relevant reports, primarily financial reports. Okay, this is the process we have to understand when you talk about the sales. The same I given with some flow diagram here. So here, inventory department. What inventory department do? The same already we discussed, they'll maintain the stock. Okay, it's a very normal general purpose of inventory department. So they'll maintain the stock. The actual sales process will start with the sales department. So the sales department receives, right? They'll receive sales orders. That's what we call sales order. So after that, they'll check with inventory for stock availability. If stock is available, so sales department will give the confirmation to customer. That simply we call as booking the sales order, or say book sales order. Booking sales order. So simply book sales order. Book sales order is nothing but confirming to the customer as we are going to supply. So whenever we move the material from sub-inventory to staging, that happens within the inventory department, the sales department will track that information in their books as a quick release. And whenever we move the material from our organization to customer organization, or else from our inventory to customer inventory, or you say our inventory to customer organization, so that movement sales department will capture in their books as a ship confirmation. Sometimes customer may return the material. So if that is the case, sales department will record that information in their books as a sales returns. Sales returns. Okay. To maintain the stock, from Oracle we have a application called as Oracle Inventory. Already that we discussed. INV. Sorry. Okay, Oracle Inventory. To record the sales orders and to book the sales orders and to perform the pick release ship confirmation and to perform the sales return activities, we have an application from Oracle called Oracle Order Management. We call it as OM. By using the Oracle Order Management, you can here receive sales order. I mentioned here receive is nothing but you can understand as creating the sales order. The moment we receive, what we'll do, we have to maintain in our books, right? That's the meaning of it. So within the Oracle Order Management, we can create the sales orders based on the confirmation from the inventory, based on the information from inventory or updates. You can give the confirmation to the customer by booking. That means within the order management, you can book the sales orders. You can just track the pick, release, ship confirmation. Physically, these activities take place in the inventory. Based on the communication from inventory, you will be tracking with order management department or within the order management application. You can track these details, and sales returns information also you can maintain within the order management. By using Oracle Order Management, you can create the sales orders, we can book, we can perform the pick, release, ship confirmation and the sales returns. What order management department will do? The order management department will pass this ship confirmation details to receivables department. Once receivables department receive the ship confirmation details from order management, this receivables department will create sales invoice. Based on that, they'll create the sales invoice. And once they receive the payment from the customer, they'll record the receipt. Once they get the payment from customer, they'll record the receipt. So this receivables department will share the receipt information with cash department. And sales invoice information, they don't share with any other departments, since that information they're getting from order management itself. So to finally, receivables department will create the sales invoices against the ship confirmation, which is done by order management or say inventory. And whenever they receive the payment from customer, that they'll record as a receipt. To create the sales invoices and receipts, we have application from Oracle that is called as Oracle Accounts Receivables. We call it as ER. Okay, by using accounts receivables or say just receivables or ER, we can create the sales invoices and we can record the receipts. The receipt information this account ER will share with cash management. What is the purpose of cash management? Within the cash management, we can maintain the bank accounts. Already these points we discussed. Here we can perform the bank statement reconciliations. Okay, we can maintain the bank accounts and we can perform the bank statement reconciliations. Once cash department get the receipt information from receivables department, so they'll perform the reconciliation by cross-checking with the bank statement. So to maintain the bank accounts and to perform the bank statement reconciliations, how we do the reconciliation, bank statement reconciliation, we'll see when we are working on cash management. Now just try to understand the concept, the point, what is the purpose we have those departments, what they do, the same we can manage from which application. That point we are trying to understand. Okay, so to maintain the bank accounts and to perform the bank statement reconciliations from Oracle, we have an application called as Oracle Cash Management. In short, you can call as CM or CE also. By using the Oracle Cash Management, you can create and maintain the bank accounts and you can perform the bank statement reconciliations. Finally, all the department will share the data with this common department. What common department will do primarily? They'll prepare the financial reports. So this department is preparing the financial reports to facilitate this environment in the system. So for this, they're given an application name, application called as Oracle General Ledger. It's not specific ledger, it's a very general, common ledger. Means where we maintain all the data. So from all the applications, data comes to this Oracle General Ledger application. For this, short name is GL. Okay, so this is how the communication takes place in the organization. the same you can just replicate in the system environment as a process across these different applications. So these are the different applications. These are the different application. So for each department, you can use separate application to manage the department related transactional activities. The applications, these all are applications, right? So just application. GL is on application, AR is on application, CM is on application. So these application only, in the technically we call as module also. Module is nothing but application only. The technical front, we call it as module. The technical aspects we call as module, normally that is application. There is no difference between application and module, both are same. Okay, so this process, okay, this process primarily getting, it's initiated by order management. Whenever they get the order from the customer, it will end with the process called as receiving the payment. Process starts with the receiving the order from the customer. It ends with once we receive the payment from the customer. So this is the typical sales process, which you can see in the organization where it ends with the customer payment. So this process we call as O2C cycle. O2C cycle. O stands for order. The two numerical letters, it's like represents this TO2. C stands for cash. That means O2C stands for order to cash. The cycle is cycle. Why we are calling a cycle here? This we are calling as P2P cycle, because cycle means it's a repeated activity. Today you want to purchase something, this is a process you have to follow. Tomorrow you want to purchase something, again you have to follow the same process. Sometimes depending on the time frame, say today you are going to purchase something and you will follow this process. Again tomorrow you are going to purchase the same item, you may not raise the requisitions to the suppliers. That you can bypass, that you can ignore. You know very well which supplier is offering which item at what price. That you may ignore directly, you may place the purchase order. But typically this is a repeated activity whenever they are doing the relevant activities. So here O2C cycle, order to cash. The process starts with a order. Here sales order, it ends with a cash by receiving the payment from customer. Typically these two are primary applications which will be involved in the O2C cycle. Somebody is going to ask you, explain about O2C cycle. You should explain all these points what we discuss. When I talk about O2C cycle, the O2C stands for order to cash cycle. So in the process of O2C, initially the sales department, or directly you can say order management, it's application name, but you can go with the generalization like this. When sales department get the order from the customers, that will be recorded as a sales order, and based on the stock availability within the inventory, the sales department will book the sales order. And whenever we move the material from sub-inventory to staging, that can be captured by sales department or say order management as a pick release. Whenever we move the material from our organization to customer organization, that can be tracked as a ship confirmation. If any returns from the customer, that can be tracked in the order management as a sales returns. The order management or sales department will pass ship confirmation details with receivables department. Based on the ship confirmation details, receivables department will prepare sales invoice, and whenever they get the payment from customer, they'll record the receipt. The receipt information, the receivables department will be sharing with the cash department. Based on that, the cash department will prepare, perform the bank statement reconciliation. Finally, all the information will be shared with a general ledger application or common department. So this is how the process flows across the different departments. The same can be managed within the system. See here, there is a communication established. Whatever the data is available in the Oracle inventory, required data would be available in the Oracle purchasing. That means data automatically flows from inventory to purchasing application, only required data. The inventory data which is required by purchasing department or purchasing application, that would be available. You no need to create records once again here. And whatever the data is required by payables department from purchasing department, the data would be available in Oracle accounts payables application. So what are the payments information available in the accounts payables, the data would be available in the cash management. Automatically that would be available. You don't need to create payments again. In the same way, there is connectivity between all these applications in the system environment within the software. That only we call as integration. Integration, connectivity. This kind of connectivity easily can be built within the ERP applications only. That is the advantage of ERP application. If you have a different applications, among those applications, you can establish the connectivity because of that data flows automatically. Here, I'll take the simple example. First, you may create the requisition manually or else you can auto-create. So, after creating the requisition, RFQs, quotations, purchase orders, receipts, purchase invoice, payments, all can be created automatically. You no need to enter any data. That is a possible. Even these activities we are doing across the applications, okay, because of the seamless integration, well, connectivity, so all can be automated without entering any single record of the data. You no need to create purchase order by entering the data. You no need to create RFQ by entering the data. You no need to create purchase invoice. If you have a requisition, you can turn into RFQs, RFQs into quotations, quotations into purchase order, purchase orders into receipts, receipts into invoices, invoice into payments. Finally, all the data you can send. That's how everything you can automate. Okay, this kind of facility you can see majorly in the ERP applications. Okay, so there are other points also we have to understand when you talk about what is ERP and all, we'll understand. But this is a primary point which enables as a future by ERP applications. Yeah, within the ERP environment only, you can see this kind of integrations and data flows. However, real-time communication happens within the organization across the department. The same communication can be built within the system environment across the applications which are designed for each and every department. So hope you remember all the short names. INV means inventory, PO means Oracle Purchasing, AP stands for Accounts Payables, GL General Ledger, CM Cash Management, FA Fixed Assets. In the O2C cycle, the same inventory, OM, Order Management, ER, Accounts Receivables, GL, General Ledger, CM, Cash Management. So this is how that O2C cycle works. So this we call as P2P. P2P, this is O2C. So we're done with the P2P and O2C. Tomorrow if somebody is going to ask, talk about, so what do you mean by P2P, explain, what do you mean by O2C, explain, the same what we are discussing today, you should be able to explain. For that, you require some sort of preparation. You have to take all these points into note. You have to read and remember. Okay. So you have to read multiple times till you remember. That's it. There is no other shortcut. So you should be able to explain in the same way, the same sequence, how we discuss, the same you have to, okay, do from your end. Okay. You should be able to explain to others. Then only you can take advantage from this. Done. So now we'll see this two cycles, P2P and O2C cycles at a time here, which are connected, which are common and all. Now first we'll talk about P2P cycle. Yes, we have inventory. Within the inventory, stock will maintain and will create the requisition, will take the approvals. Then inventory will have a communication with the PO about this approved requisition based on that purchasing department. PO means Oracle Purchasing. They'll create the RFQs, they'll create the quotation, they do analysis. They choose the best quotation, they'll place the purchase order, they record the GRN once they receive the material, and they may perform the purchase returns also. And finally, this PO, purchasing department, Oracle Purchasing, will pass the information to accounts payables. So based on that GRN information, the AP will record the purchase invoice, they'll process the payment. If that purchase invoice is related to asset purchase, okay, this purchase invoice is related to asset purchase, that information they'll share with FA, and based on that information, fixed assets department will create asset and they'll calculate depreciation. Finally, the data assets FA, fixed assets, will share with the GL for financial reports, and this accounts payables will share the payment information with cash management. Okay, they'll share with the cash management for bank statement reconciliation purpose. Finally, the cash management will share that information with the general ledger. So that's all about P2P cycle, right? what I just selected, that is P2P cycle. When you talk about OTC cycle, the OM, order management, is nothing but sales department. Record, they'll record the sales orders, the moment they get from the customer, they'll record the sales orders, and based on the stock availability within the inventory, they'll book the sales order, they'll perform the pick release, okay, they'll do the activity within the inventory that will be tracked by OM order management. Whenever shipping happens, so that will be captured by this order management as a ship confirmation. And if any sales returns, that also can be handled by order management. Finally, the order management will share ship confirmation details with account receivables department. Based on that, account receivables department will create sales invoice. Whenever they get the payment from the customer, they'll record the receipt. The same receipt information, this receivables department will be sharing with the cash management. This receipt information they'll share with the cash management for bank statement reconciliation purpose. Finally, all this data will be shared with the general ledger to prepare the financial reports. If you look at this flow diagram, you can understand there are few applications. Each application you can call as a module also. Few applications are commonly involved in these two cycles. In the two cycles, these common applications you can see. Inventory is connected with the P2P and O2C. Cash management, from AP it get payment data and AR it get receipts data, and general ledger it will get the data from all the application. That means inventory, cash management and the general ledger, these are common applications in P2P and O2C cycles. When you are working on P2P, we'll come across these three applications. When you are working on O2C also, you'll come across these applications. But the primary applications in P2P, these. And in P2P cycle, these are the primary applications. Of course, inventory also will consider. In O2C, these two applications are very primary. But if we are going to talk about cycles, whatever you discussed, you should be able to address the complete cycle of process and how those connectivity communication happens between the departments, how data flows from one application to another application. This is all about P2P and O2C cycles. If you have this understanding, so whatever further we are going to discuss, those will become very easy. Out of this P2P and O2C, this is our area. This is the financials area. Okay. This is the financials part. The above section falls under SCM. This is supply chain management. Supply chain. Okay, these three applications part of SCM, supply chain management. Not only these, there are many other applications also, but so when you are going to work on financials, this has some communication with the finance, so we have to understand. So this we call as supply chain management, SCM. So this section is, okay, all this belongs to financials. These are financial applications. Above these applications are SCM applications. So SCM applications always will have a communication with the financial application. So when you are going to work on financial applications, we should understand basics from SCM also. So that is the reason, very basic level, we'll be working on inventory, purchasing and order management. But our primary focus would be on financials. So this is what we have to understand. Any questions on this P2P or O2C cycles, please?
Yeah, Laxman, this is Prashant here.
Yeah,
my question here is, by any chance, AR, will it be linked with FA?
Sorry?
By any chance, AR, account receivable, will be dealing with FA?
See, there is a cases. So when you talk about retiring the asset, asset may be in the position to sell.
Uh-huh.
But receivables is not the purpose of selling the fixed assets, right?
Okay.
So that is the reason there is no connectivity, there is no integration between that. But whatever the asset you are retiring in the fixed asset, so that information you can enter in the receivables as a miscellaneous activity. That is not your regular sales activity.
Okay.
Okay. So there is no connectivity, but you can manage that information.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi, you mentioned from all the modules, the information goes to GL, right?
Correct.
So what kind of information goes from inventory and purchase and order management to GL?
So which transactions will generate accounting entries? When you say accounting entries, what sort of reporting is required by organization? All those transactional data. If you talk about inventory, within the inventory transactions, receiving the material, when you talk about PO, so GRN related information and purchase returns related transactions information, when you talk about AP, purchase invoice and payment related information, when you talk about FA, asset creation information and depreciation information, cash management, so cash related transaction data, and from receivables, sales invoice and receipt. So those transactions will flow. To see the proof, in our classes we'll be creating the accounting entries and we'll be sending to GL and we'll go and verify also. Okay.
Okay. So it doesn't have to be only financial data.
No, all the applications. If you are going to use some other applications also, say you are running the payroll application, you are using the HR and payroll application. The payroll data also will be getting into GL. So,
okay.
So which transactions require accounting entry generation? All those transactions data will flow to GL from the respective applications. Say you are going to use costing application, from costing data will come. You are going to use some project related billing application, billing data also will come to GL. Reporting purpose. Yeah.
Okay.
From supply chain, which will go to GL? Lakshman, I just joined now, so yeah.
Supply chain?
Which are the transactions which would hit GL?
Yeah. Inventory transactions. Okay, so you will receive the material, right? The transaction data, and within the inventory, you may do some material transfers. You may record some miscellaneous material transaction within the inventory. All the data goes to GL. When you talk about order management, the pick release and ship confirmation data and sales returns data goes to GL. When you talk about PO, so the receipt you can create within the inventory or purchasing also. If you are creating from here, data goes to GL and GRN information. Even you can create accounting for purchase orders. The data and purchase returns data goes to GL. So most of the transaction data goes, okay. Your sales order you can create later, you may not book it, right? You may get the order from the customer and since stock is not available, you may not book it. Once booking is done, further activities only matter. That is the reason that relevant transactions only, accounting entries takes place, that flows to GL.
So where the revenue gets hit, right?
Revenue, when I talk about revenue, sales invoice. And of course, that would get initiated, ship confirmation. Okay. Once ship confirmation is done, once it's a booking is done, from here, the revenue process starts. And here, revenue would get recognized. With the sales invoice creation, their revenue will come into the picture.
And you will be giving us the order flow also, right?
Yeah, we'll be working on this. This is a primary focus. Even I'll take you through in the classes how to set up inventory, how to perform the basic inventory transactions which will be connected with the PO, and how to set up the PO, how to perform purchase order, receipt, purchase returns, and how to create the invoices in the AP based on the purchasing department activities, and how to set up OM, how to create the sales order, how to book quick release ship confirmation, how to get the data into receivables as a sales invoice, all I'll be covering.
Mm-hmm. So, say if in US or any other place, if you have an idea, how many, what is the percentage of jobs, since we have two tracks, right? One is supply chain, one is financials, kind of broadly. If there are 100 jobs available in Oracle EBS, how many are SCM and how many are financials? Lakshman, you have any clue?
Yes. 70%. 70% finance, 30% SCM.
Oh, I see. And why is it so?
One second. One point here. See, all the organizations may not be supply chain management process driven, right? But every organization is finance process driven. They may not be more into supply chain management activities. There is some organization, they don't have any inventory. They don't purchase anything. They may be into some services, but still finance required. Supply chain management is not required, even for service-oriented organizations. Okay, so that's how there is a huge difference, huge gap between these in terms of the competition or ratio. So if you say 100 jobs available in the market on finance and SCM, I could say 70% jobs goes to finance account, remaining 25-30% to SCM.
And in finance, which modules is?
Not like that. You have to be, at least you have to be okay with this. In the market, some companies says, what else you know other than financials? That is the market now. Because competition.
AP, AR and GL is most important.
Yeah? No, not like that. So if you know GL, APR, they may not take you into the project because client is going to implement fixed assets. Definitely every company will implement fixed assets who are going to use APR and GL. It's don't segregate, don't go with choosing a selection here. These are just minimum basic applications. Core applications when I talk about finance. Okay. You should be okay with minimum these five applications. If you are going to select, so there won't be any, there won't be any demand for your profile.
Right. And coming to, we see a lot of cloud. So is it, what is your suggestion since you have a good experience? Should we go for financial Oracle or cloud, Fusion Cloud Financials?
See, when you talk about cloud financials or cloud SCM, these came into the market and stabilized from last 2 years. Okay. And if any company is going to take any consultant to work on cloud, definitely they'll look at their overall experience on Oracle applications. If you just claim yourself for working on cloud financials, they look at your years of experience on finance side. Now in the market, the most of the people who are learning this cloud financials or cloud SCM, there are already EBS experts. Tomorrow you cannot give any competition to them. You can learn this, and if you just apply for any job, so in front of their experience, they don't give more weightage to our profile. The most of the practices, the consulting companies are hiring or looking for the candidates who are okay with Oracle EBS financials and do Oracle Fusion financials, or Oracle EBS SCM and do Oracle Fusion SCM. The reason is most of the projects, still every company is running, and new projects also they are getting an EBS along with the Fusion. If they take one resource, they should have a flexibility of utilizing the resource. If not in cloud, in EBS. If not in EBS, in Fusion. That is the reason if you are good at just cloud, and even cloud is not in the market when you talk about finance and SCM, not more than 2 years as a stabilized versions. So even there is no great scope where you can go and say, I'm working on financial from last 4 years. Just if you want to talk in that way. No scope. So that is the reason. You can, anyone like you, they can go with EBS. With EBS, there is a good scope to get the job after learning EBS. If you have a plan of learning cloud, so you by learning this EBS, you can say you know 80% of cloud. Once you start with EBS, once you start with the cloud, you'll be finding everything same, because Oracle taken the EBS finance product into cloud. Only that, the environment, how it is, how things works in the cloud environment with respect to the application, what changes they did, that you have to understand. Again, it is not going to be new learning for anyone. The best thing what anyone can do is, if they are learning this Oracle application first time, this, my suggestion is they can start with EBS financials, then they can do cloud financials if they are interested. If they are not interested, no worries. They can proceed with this EBS financials only. They can get the job in the market. Oracle is going to support this EBS financials till 2030, 12 more years. Okay, that is the reason we got good scope with EBS financials itself.
On supply chain,
if you are interested,
how long?
Okay, you can learn it. Yeah, please.
Supply chain also 2030. How long Oracle will support
EBS supply chain? Everything comes under that umbrella. Finance and projects, HRMS, CRM, manufacturing, other areas of application also.
Fusion and cloud is same or is it different?
Fusion product you will be using with a cloud technology. That's it. Both are same.
Both. And says today 100 jobs come on financials. I see, because a lot of people, they call up and say, do you know cloud? Do you know cloud? So like 100 jobs in, say, US or India, how many you think personally are cloud and how many are EBS on financial?
See, on cloud, we have less jobs in the market. See, your statement is correct. They ask you, do you know cloud? If you say, yes, I know only cloud, they don't choose you. The guy who has EBS experience, if they says, I know cloud, they look at their profile, then they'll pick their CV. That's it.
So can I say 20 cloud, 80 EBS, something like that as on today?
It may not be right figures you and me are going to calculate. So the simple point what I'm trying to say is, there are openings in the market on the cloud, not more than EBS.
Oh, okay.
That's it. Simple point, in the market, yes, who are using Oracle applications, more than 90% of clients are using EBS finance, not cloud.
Okay. As on today.
Yes. See, forget about how many positions. We have to look at our profile. That is the point I'm trying to highlight. Okay. There may be n number of openings, but do we get scope of getting that job? No. If you are okay with EBS first, and then if you are okay with the cloud, you will be eligible for that. Just by learning cloud, you cannot, there won't be any great scope of getting the job. All the time, the EBS guys who has a great amount of experience and who knows cloud, easily they can get into that positions. Fine.
And another
question. Love.
Yeah, go.
Yeah, please.
Lakshman, sorry.
Please go ahead.
Lakshman.
Yeah, please go ahead. Please go ahead.
Yes, sorry. Sorry to interrupt you in between. Yeah, my question here is, while doing hands-on, are we going to cover how the transactions accounting entries will flow from PO, INV and OM to the GL?
See, simple point. We are going to focus on finance. Our course is finance.
Yes.
But to give some extra edge for our learning, I am covering. So whatever you required, see, there is, say, for example, if 4 or 5 years guy, what level of information they know from finance or SEM, that level of information I'm going to share with you.
Okay.
If you are expecting everything from per PO, inventory, OM, definitely we have to go with SEM course.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
But a basic setup like work order type and customer and defaulting rules, validation, in OM we will be doing that, right?
Yeah, say we'll do that setups which are required to run the basic process flow within the OM. We'll do all the basic configuration. Without configuration, sure, you cannot create sales order and you cannot do anything. Finally, you cannot get the data into AR. We'll be creating everything. We'll create our own on our own how we do in real time project.
Right. Say say if you take a Dell as a customer, then we'll create an item in inventory.
Everything,
then
that's what I'm telling. Everything will create. Right. We're not going to use anything which is already exist in the system.
Okay.
We'll create everything from the scratch.
So in that case, maybe even if there is a kind of supply chain, somebody says, okay, I need an order management guy, maybe we would be in a good position, right, Laxman?
Yes, definitely, yes. You will be, after this training, you will be knowing those areas also.
And it is early morning here in US. Can the time change in case if we want to go with you, Laxman?
No, time is fixed, 7 to 9.
2 hours. Huh? How many days course is it?
So it goes to 2 to 3 months because it would be around 120 hours.
Okay.
See, if you don't have if your the timings are not flexible, I can suggest one thing. You can go with the videos from the previous batches. Those are very much detailed. There were many participants who were part of that batch, and many questions and answers, everything detail level discussed. If you go through that videos also, you can get the complete information which really you require to start with your job.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you can think on it. Okay, any questions from others, please? And just here, I want to understand, may I know your name, please, because I could see your name as waiting for the name. Your name? Just you. Just I'm asking you, like you just, we just
know. Yeah, you're asking me?
Yeah, you
only. Okay. This is Kumar here, yeah?
Kumar.
Yeah.
Kumar, fine, okay.
So when is, I could not attend today because I just attended 10 minutes back.
Okay.
So I got
sharing this video. Okay, you'll be getting this video maybe within 1 hour, and just you can play and you can come back to me if you have any questions in the tomorrow session.
Okay.
Yeah.
You're based in Hyderabad, right?
Correct. Hyderabad. Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah. Fine, Kumar. Thank you. Any questions from others?
And Laxman?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, one quick question. See, now we see these videos here and there and YouTube and all, right? A lot of training and that. So what is your personal suggestion on learning self in YouTube or any other videos or attending a class like yours? Can you tell, fundamentally what would be the major advantages?
See, when you talk about YouTube videos, you don't get complete course videos. That is the first point. Okay. The second point is learning through self-paced videos, that totally depending on the trainer. Which trainer videos you are going to play offline, that really matter. But I can guarantee you, if you go through my class videos, you can get what level of knowledge you require. And if you attend the classes, you can have a quick question if you have any doubt. Even if you go through the videos also, all the by just understanding all category of the participants, we discussed and I delivered the certain concepts or discussions. So you can find the good information. If you have any question, you can, if that is a simple question, you can email me, or else if you have a set of questions, we can schedule the call and we can discuss on those.
Yeah. Maybe in the training you have a two-way interaction, right?
Yeah. What two-way interaction?
No. When you are talking, there is a two-way interaction, but in videos it is one-way interaction.
Yeah, there is no interaction. Just it's all about you will just play the videos. Yes, here live interaction. There won't be any interaction which you see. Just you have to play and listen that.
Right.
Yes. Fine. So, any questions from others, please? Okay. Fine. Seems to no questions. We'll share this today video within one.
Final question.
And one second. Yeah. 1 second. Let me complete. Okay. So you can just we'll be sharing this video within 1 hour. You can go through it. And if you have any questions, we can discuss in the tomorrow session. And tomorrow also we'll be starting the same time. And in tomorrow session, I'll just talk about the application before we get into the application, understanding about this product in the overall high level, and slowly we'll just talk about, I'll just introduce about this product, how the terminology which we'll be using related to this entire product or specific areas of application, some generic common areas of information which you have to understand before we start with the product, that we'll be discussing in the tomorrow session. Yeah, please, any questions?
So after your training, how good are we in a position to crack an interview, Lakshmi?
That's what I said. Like, you can get the enough information where you.
Lakshman.
Yeah, please.
Yes, sorry to interrupt you. Because these type of questions you can take offline, no? Because so many other people will be in the call.
Yeah, correct.
I hope may not be relevant to the all people these questions.
Okay, fine.
That's what I feel.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Maybe no discussions, please. One second, because I totally agree with you. But since this is the first session for the respective participant, maybe these questions were entertaining. Anyway, these should be discussed. Yes, as you said, like these we may take in the end of the session after all participants' questions. Yeah. So from all the participants, no issue with that. Okay, fine. We'll consider everything. Okay. Don't worry about it.
Fine. Lakshman, other participants are silent. That's why we are asking, you know, otherwise they can talk.
Please don't rise on that. My request is please ignore it. Yeah, that's what I was talking about. Yeah, totally. That's what, so totally nothing.
The
wrong.
Class is over.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, we're done for today. Any questions, you may stay back. Otherwise you can draw from. Please,
thank you.
One point is, in the initial classes, generally everybody will be having their own questions that may not be useful for all the people. That is the reason just these questions we are discussing in the end of the class only. We're done for today, and I was just asking the question since there was no questions from other participants. After waiting some time, I could hear these questions from the same participant.
Laxman, see, I don't know who was talking, but these are very relevant.
One second, Kumar. You no need to talk on that. Ignore it, please. Find any questions from anyone, please. I said totally agreed. Two statements are acceptable, no doubt on that. That's what we are discussing again. So there is no conflict in that. Fine. Any questions from others, please?